Welcome to Riverbend Talon on WBGZ. Brought to you by the Halpin Music Company.
Also brought to you by Mr. Matt Van Morse of Macias Insurance. Dennis is my name.
Pigpen is what they call me.
No, they don't call you. You call yourself that.
I call myself. It is the name I have given myself and stolen from another man.
We all know you as Scrap.
Well, some names just won't go away. Some names stick forever.
Mm-hmm.
I guess it just fit. I don't know.
That was
I know you was Bash, so there you go.
Right,
there you go.
But, you know, I never, like, called myself that.
Well, you had a show called that. That's
No, I was trying to get my music played on the radio without anyone knowing. Right?
Right. Incognito.
Then the radio show did well.
Absolutely.
Really well.
Absolutely. Johnny Bash on the Mosh.
And I was like, well, now I want them to know that's my band.
That's
how it worked out.
And it also worked out that you did get your music played in the beginning with nobody really knowing until they figured it out.
Most people knew how to do that on college radio. Most of the guys there were in bands.
I knew two that weren't, and they were into sports.
No. Most of the guys on this show are in bands.
Oh, yeah, well, you know.
In case you're just tuning in for the first time, we're sorry.
You might want to just reach out to the old dial and give her a turn right now.
Just crank her down.
Right. Oh, yeah, the 6 to 7 Thursdays here, we do Riverbend Talent. We try to incorporate all sorts of talented people. We've had authors, and we've had actors, and we've had people who put on weird, you know, all kinds of art and all kinds of good stuff. But mainly it is musicians, and that's because this is a musical town. If you don't realize it, we probably got as many great musicians on this side of the river as the other side, the old big city, the shiny big city over there.
Well, as we have found out through our research and talking to the people who were here back in the day, pre-rock and roll, we made it. St. Louis, east side.
We built this city.
What Bonnie tell us, right?
East side is where
The guys come from the east side and went over to St. Louis and played the gigs.
Yep, and all the guys from St. Louis was watching the guys like Ike from the east side.
Yeah.
And, all right, so what do we got going on this fine evening? I know we got a big interview with Christopher J. and Samantha Grimes coming up.
It's J. Christopher.
I'm slightly dyslexic.
You should know our guest.
I'm slightly dyslexic or dyslexic. I get it. I get things all jumbled in my head.
Well, you know, people are used to it.
Maybe I'm just high. I don't know.
And, you know, we got all those, what they call subscribers on our YouTube. So they're down with your mistakes.
They expect them at this point.
It's made you so popular. Yeah, I'll tell you what's popular on a Thursday night, the Sea Shanty Sing-Along going on at Morrison's Irish Pub.
That has been going on for 7 years at least.
Remember during the flood?
Oh, yeah.
They were like floating on floaties, doing sea shanties down there. The bar wasn't even open. Them guys still showed up.
During the pandemic, they just set up outside the door and played when no one was allowed inside. So
that's happening. Our buddy's Lazy Lester doing the night market at 7.
And that is right next to Jacoby's on Broadway. If you haven't been to the night market, it's going to cool down a little bit tonight, trust me. The sun's going to go down. We're going to drop a good 15, 20 degrees. It'll be a good time.
I think it's wonderful out there compared to some of the temps we've had to deal with lately. Did you see anyone talking about heading over to Busch Stadium for the big... I don't know what you call it, like a hairband world tour or something that was Motley Crue and Poison and...
Joan Jett.
Yeah, that one I like.
Yeah,
there's somebody else.
Yeah,
I'm missing.
I can't remember.
I'm missing one of the bands.
Yeah, I can't remember. I remember Motley
Crue. Oh, it's important.
Poison.
It's so important.
It is. It is. Hey, you know, to all...
Sticks. Was it? No?
No, I don't think so.
Okay. I was hoping. I'm thinking of Super Jam. We'll get to that later. Yeah. Anyways, and Styx wasn't part of that either, but also going on tonight, though, Borderline, 7 to 11 at Fast Eddie's in Alton, open mic at Raging Cajun later at 9. Not sure if they're still doing it out at Baker's and Hale. Didn't see a listing for it. I know Everhart and Light hadn't posted anything in a while, and we've seen names change in there, so maybe they're trying something new. I know they're doing Bike Night now on on Wednesday night.
Oh, yeah.
Or maybe that's like a drive-in night.
Yeah,
they're doing Wednesday thing. Remember, like from last summer.
Yeah. I think they had Matt Tall playing out there last night.
And his brother Larry Short. Anyways, out in Bethalto, Central Park, Hill Williams.
Yeah,
not to be confused with Hump Williams. 7 to 8. That's country, right?
It is.
Karaoke with DJ Tony, always on Thursday nights down at Martin's Tunes and Eats. Somebody's at George's Local Brew and Rockabilly Revival doing the Grafton's music in the park tonight from 7 to 9.
We got Come Closer from 6 to 10 at Wigglers in Holiday Shores. And then the Acoustic DNA is going to be playing until 10:30. Down at Patrick's, that's kicking off at 6. And it is also, I don't see it on here, but it is their Music in the Park night. I'm overlooking it, but it is also the Music in the Park night for Granite City.
I think they do that monthly. Although I tried to look it up today and the site was gone.
Yeah,
I don't know what happened. I looked at the note I had from Michelle, and
I was going to say it was actually there was something on cottonmouth.org.
So I got a couple different ones. So
yeah, there was a band listed tonight for Civic Park on cottonmouth.org.
Well, it should have printed out then.
Maybe
it disappeared.
It might have. Somebody took it. Anyway,
well, we have investigated this building and found
I said we do more than music. We've done multiple ghost investigations. Also, we've got Experience Live Music Row. That's going on down in Belleville. You got like 5 or 6 different venues real close to each other, all with live music going. And then over in St. Louis at the Venice Cafe, Bring Me the Fires and Susie Q. That's a $5 show starting at 9:15.
Susie Q in August.
Susie. Oh, and August. I didn't even see that. I thought it was just it's almost August. No.
Yeah, you would. $5 for that at the Venice Cafe. And by the way, a new release tonight from Bring Me the Fires. Big Red Tie. And that features Charlie Brown, Adam Huck, I guess it's Huck, H-U-C-K-E, and Aaron Chandler.
There you go. And that is the first release from Bring Me the Fires. I heard they're working on their second release and going to finally, after that, do an entire album down the road at Lighthouse Studio, is my understanding.
We have producer Jay Christopher coming up in just a bit here on Riverbend Talent, our guest tonight, and Samantha Grimes. They got together to do some wild and crazy things, man. They've had quite a bit of success with some recordings they've done right out of Alton right here. And we're going to hear all about that, so looking forward to it. Like Songwriter of the Year type stuff.
Oh, yeah. Samantha is from Wisconsin. But, man, just a fabulous person, as far as I can tell, great songwriter. So
Train wreck,
absolutely.
We'll hear about the big hit.
And more to come. So let's move on to Friday.
We can do that thanks to Halpin Music Company, Mr. Matt Van Voorhis, and Macias Insurance. And we will tell you that Lauren Waters is playing Friday at the Flock Food Truck Park in Alton from 6 to 9. Always doing the Irish music at Morrison's on Friday and Saturday night. At the Conservatory, 314 in Hazebond. 9 o'clock, a $7 cover on that one at the Conservatory in Alton. The Grand Band at Shea Maryland's at 8 o'clock in Alton. Pianos down at Ragin' Cajun. And Trent and Nanney, 2 to 6 in Generation X, 7:30 to 11:30 at Fast Eddie's in Alton. Also, one more Alton show, Lovebuzz, 7 to 10 at the Lodge at Lovejoy.
We got the Owlz starting at 7 p.m. at Baker's and Hale out in Godfrey, while Dustin Coleman will be up at Bethalto's Laux Brickhouse going until 11 p.m. tonight. Gabie, 7 p.m. at the Moose in Wood River, and then Kevin Gruen, 7 to 10, George's Local Brew this Friday evening up in Jerseyville.
In Grafton, they got the open mic with Steve Mellas on Friday. Scott and Karl at the Loading Dock starting at 6. Jake Weber at 8 o'clock. He might not be playing. You know, I see him post here that he posted Skate or Die. I just broke my wrist.
Huh.
So he may
he
be.
He might not.
He might show him just sing.
Yeah.
But
you
just
never know with him.
Yeah. What do I see? And best wishes to your wrist, Jake. We need you back.
Yeah. Backwoods Duece.
Yep.
7 to 11 p.m. at the Grafton Pub, weather permitting. Then we got Jim on Keys at Aries Resort in Grafton going from 3 to 7 p.m. on Friday. 8 p.m. till midnight at Deutz Village Inn. Somebody's going to be there. I'm not sure who, but I guarantee someone's going to be there.
That's why we leave the links at cottonmouth.org, because they update this stuff after we even already went through the list. And you can find those links to get you to the update. So Frankie and the House Shakers, 8 o'clock at Patrick's in Granite City. And here's one of them I was wanting to get back to. So Gypsy's in town this weekend, Friday and Saturday night. This is the 45th year since Super Jam, the anniversary.
Wow.
So that was back on, Super Jam was on July 9th, 1977. 45,000 folks packed into Busch Stadium. It was a charity event. Did you know that?
I did not realize that.
Yeah, Special Olympics.
Oh, wow.
And REO Speedwagon, Uncle Ted.
Sweaty Teddy.
That's right, Ted Nugent. Head East.
Ooh.
Gypsy. There was one more band. Who do you think it was?
Let's see, we got Head East.
Right.
They're from Illinois. And we got Styx. Did you say that?
No.
Oh, we were talking about them earlier.
Yeah.
We got Gypsy.
You're never going to get it.
Okay, go ahead and give it to me.
It's Judas Priest.
No, you are correct. I would have never guessed that in that lineup. Oh, my gosh.
There you go.
A pretty hippy dippy lineup, and then just killing it with the leather and metal at the end.
It was a big deal for Gypsy because they had broken up and actually got, well, we'll get into it a little bit more when we get to Saturday, but they reformed the lineup just to play the show because St. Louis was such a big deal for Gypsy for, you know why,
Casey.
That place used to work.
Ah, Casey!
Yeah.
Yeah. Hey, yeah, you know what? So, they can say it's Ted Nugent, or not Ted Nugent, Sammy Hagar could say the same thing. I mean, he'd be washing dishes somewhere, selling Chevrolets if it wasn't for Gacy.
Right.
Anyway.
Hey, Blue Suede Crew, 8 o'clock at Concerts in the Park in Edwardsville on Friday. Strangers Duo 6 to 9 at Big Daddy's in Edwardsville. Let's see. Alex Reyna is listed from 7 to 10 at 1818 Chop House in Edwardsville, but I also seen earlier that Riley Holtz was supposed to play. I looked at their website, and they had them both listed.
Yeah, doubleheader.
So, but they're promoting the heck out of Alex Reyna. I believe he's from out of town, if I remember correctly.
All right.
Grammy-nominated Gavin M playing 7 to 10 at Global Brew. I'm not sure if that's exactly true, but it was something like that.
All right.
I tried to look it up, but it's not mentioned anywhere. He's a humble guy, I guess. Dave Horton, 7 o'clock at the Moose in Edwardsville. On Friday, and Lanny and Julie, 5 o'clock. Or, I don't even
know. Lanny and Julie, 5 and 4 p.m.?
Yeah, yeah. Some nights this gets long, brother.
Yeah.
Lanny and Julie, 4 o'clock, and Blue Marlin, 8 o'clock at the Firefighters Homecoming in Maryville. I got a 5 stuck in there.
It happens sometimes. We got 10 String Dream, 5:30 to 8 p.m. at the American Legion Fish Fry in Collinsville this Friday evening, while Kurt Copeland will be down the road in Collinsville at the Old Herald Brewery going on until 9 p.m. Of course, there's the Experience Live Music Row we told you about going on Thursday, Friday, and Saturday, all summer long in Belleville.
Mm-hmm.
Then we got Cherry Bomb, 9 p.m. at TR's in Belleville also.
Mm-hmm. Flipside at Old Time Pub, their debut there up in Highland. And check this out, Abe Best is going on.
Okay.
So it's featuring John Waite.
Wow, look at there.
Are you missing
there
him at all?
I ain't missing him at all.
You're not missing him
at all? Not since he's been gone.
I'll tell you, I'm missing. Look who's with him.
Feel nice.
Yeah.
Nice. That'd be a fun show right there. Little John Waite, little Feel, and Josie Louder Band.
Mm-hmm.
So there you go. That's all happening at the Boss Center Plaza in Springfield.
Yeah. Congrats to Feel. Getting to open up there for John Waite.
Yeah. He was in the Babies, you know.
Looks like Mike Judy's got him a sponsor, too.
I saw that.
Sirius XM Octane.
Nice. Good for him.
Helping out bringing Memphis May Fire, From Ashes to New, Rain City, Drive, and Wolves at the Gate. $23 charge at the Red Flag Friday night in St. Louis.
There you go. That is the Friday night. Moving on to Saturday, July 9th. We got Lauren Waters, 8 a.m. to noon at the Alton Farmers Market. And then McAtee, 7 p.m. at Shea, Maryland. We got pianos going on at the Ragin Cajun, while the Mad Baileys will be down at the Lodge at Lovejoy Saturday until 10 p.m. Fast Eddie's has Naked Soul 2 to 6 and Gen X 7:30 to 11:30. Jake Weber, if his wrist is not broken too badly.
It might just be the Lonesome Drifters.
It might just be the Lonesome Drifters. And no, that's going on at Baker's and Hale and Godfrey, you know, if his arm isn't too jacked up, I guess.
Yeah. Foreplay, 9 o'clock at the Pump House in Wood River. DJ Adocat at the Franchise in Wood River at 10 p.m. Raleigh Overmeyer, 2 to 6. And Little Known Fact in the Lowdowns, 8 p.m. to 12 a.m. at Martin's Tunes and Eats in Wood River. Let's see.
Yeah, some Rogers.
Rogers and Enehaus, yeah. Go ahead.
Rogers and Enehaus is doing it from 3 p.m. to 7 p.m. at the Grafton Winery. City Heat just down the road at the Loading Dock will kick it off at 5 p.m. Matt Tall also in Grafton. He's at the Bloody Bucket Saloon from 8 p.m. till 11, while the Grafton Oyster Bar has the Backwoods Burden going starting at 7 p.m. Hooky, weather permitting, doing 2 to 6, and Vintage Brotherhood 7 to 11, also at the Grafton Pub. Or did I skip a day? Because we already said
that. No, you
Grafton.
Did. You're all
okay,
right.
There,
yeah.
We go. There we go.
Dan Spro, 12 to 3, and John Jarrett Littlefield, 3 to 7 at Aries Resort in Grafton to wrap up the Grafton schedule for Friday. And the Skylark Brothers across the pond at Portage des Sioux, the Longshot Tiki Bar, 2 p.m. for the Skylark Brothers.
Granite City's got it going on. Root Digging Nation, 9:30 at Patrick's. DJ Fat Albert, 8 p.m.
Spelt with a P-H.
Spelt with a P-H.
How'd that promo go? I forgot that promo.
I did too. DJ Fat Albert, spelled with a P-H. That is 8 p.m. at Tegan's in Granite City. Flipside, 8 p.m. at Hooch and 16th in Granite City. So they got it going on down there.
Yeah.
Moving up to Edwardsville, we got Dave Horton at the Public Foundry House. That's 2 to 6 p.m. Patrick and Ricky, 9 a.m. to noon. Early morning job for them at Goshen Market in Edwardsville. And then here we go, Summer Jam.
Yeah.
We got Money Shot.
Not to be confused with Super Jam.
No, no. And this is at the Holiday Shores Marina in Edwardsville. And here's the lineup. We got Money Shot, noon to 2 p.m. Drew Schaefer, I guess it is after that. Doesn't have a time exactly. Lexi Schlimmer and the Robert Perry Band, 7 to 10 p.m. So it starts at noon, yeah. Ends at 10 p.m., and those are the bands that are playing.
And both Friday and Saturday night, Gypsy playing at the Wild E Theater. And we talked about being the anniversary of Super Jam back on July 9th, 1977. And Pigpen remembered right away seeing Judas Priest. You were about 5 years old,
right?
77.
That's not. Yeah. We've been 7 years old.
Seven.
Yeah,
okay. Yeah. Hey, ooh, look at all those sevens for you.
Yeah, that's it's a pretty magical number.
You know, here's the lineup, man. Originally, and they're from Minnesota. James Walsh was a vocal keyboard player. Enrico Rosenbaum, vocalist guitar player. James or Jim C. Johnson, guitar, J. Epstein drums, Donnie Larson on bass, and the personnel changed over each album. Enrico died in 1979, but the reason we talk about the Super Jam reunion show, so they put out their first album in 1970. It was a double album. Nobody did that. They got long jam songs. You know any of their songs? Can you remember any Gypsy songs?
Oh, man, I just came home from a five-day music festival. Mm-hmm. I can't remember my own name. I barely remembered how to get here tonight. So I do have Gypsy. I've got some Gypsy. I just can't think of anything right now.
So they put that album out on Metro Media, double album, 1970. You might want to check and see if you have this.
I might have it.
Okay. Now, they re-released it later because you couldn't find it. So I think it was in the 90s, 1979, they re-released the first album because it was hard to find, and the re-release versions went for $100 a piece.
Wow.
In 1979.
Wow.
So check your vinyl, folks.
There you go.
1971, they did on the same label, In the Garden, and then RCA took over in 1972. Now, all the songs on those first three, you know, had the double album, the single, they were long jams. They had, 10, 12-minute songs.
Right.
Dead and Gone was one of those songs from that 70s album. It was 10:54. Now, some of those they chopped down and got airplay with, but Casey played the full version, yeah, time, right? Yep. Yeah, and so that's where Gypsy got its St. Louis fame.
Yeah.
But in 75, they started doing 3 to 5 minute songs and had commercial success. Antithesis was the name of that album. And let's see if you remember any of these. You had the title track. You had Day After Day, So Many Promises, and Young Gypsy. All got airplay off that album.
Hmm. I remember the long jams. I don't really remember them being the short 3-minute band, but again, my brain is.
Right. So then 73.
On eggs? I don't know.
73, Unlock the Gates, Don't Get Mad, Get Even. That song on that one. And they kind of started fading at that point. Reformed in 77 without Walsh, which is interesting, just for Super Jam.
There you go.
And Walsh started the James Walsh Gypsy Band in 78. That's how that goes, right? Yeah, and they disappeared to like 96. So, And that was like a reunion, too, like a 20-year type thing.
And if you want to see it, what it sounds like now, all you have to do is go up to Wildy Theater either Friday or Saturday evening and purchase your ticket, and you get in and see the band Gypsy and the Super Jam, 45-year reunion of Super Jam. So,
as far as you can see, as much as you can feel. That's one of their songs from In the Garden. So, yeah, that's happening Friday and Saturday at the Wildy. Also going on Saturday, Spencer McDowell at Reese's Brewery in Edwardsville. Lanny and Julie at 4 o'clock, and Blue Marlin again at 8 o'clock at the Firefighters Homecoming in Maryville. And, the Blue Marlin Band, you don't get to see them all the time, so definitely get out and check them out. Great interview we do with Scott Marlin. You can check out all our old shows on our YouTube channel, all found at cottonmouth.org. Sweet Bottom 1 to 4 and Andrew Dahl 5 to 9 at Edley's Barbecue in Glen Carbon on Saturday. Want to mention that the cabinet Judy Creek's just going to go on vacation till the 12th.
Yeah, well, good for them.
I think so, too. Good. That's pretty cool.
They need
so
it.
So they're going to close down it. And, yeah, take a vacay.
Then we got a benefit concert for Angel O'Malley Lipham with music by Dale Papp, 10-String Dream, and Strange Buffalo. This is sponsored by the Old Herald Brewery, and it's happening at the Miners Theater in Collinsville starting at 7 p.m. this Saturday.
Borderline doing the Fireman's Picnic in Bunker Hill at 8 o'clock with fireworks at 9:30. Power Trip up in Highland at the Corner Pub starting at 9 p.m. and going to the wee hours. Hat Trick 6 to 10 at Wild Pickens in Chesterfield. Always going on down in Belleville now, and they're keeping it up, Pigpen.
Yeah.
They get all those bands. It's a list of them. You can check it out at cottonmouth.org. Experience Live Music Row, and it looks like about 10 bands playing.
On Saturday. Yeah. It looks like quite a packed house there. So
Pat Liston's in Pocahontas.
Oh,
5
nice.
5 to 9
Poca
on
what?
Saturday. Yeah, Pocahontas. You Poca what?
Mm-hmm.
Mike Judy presents a Lesana, I think is how you say it. $26 for that one. 6:30 at the Old Rock House in St. Louis. And Inner Outlines does their Live at Busch Stadium show that we talked about on a recent episode of
River Bend Talent.
Is brought to you by
Matt Van Voorhis of Macias Insurance and, of course, Halpin Music Company.
We got stuff going on Sunday, too, but we don't have time to tell you about it. We need to scoot along and get along.
Yeah, we a few weeks back interviewed a lady we had never met before named Samantha Grimes, a very fine lady. And she has hooked up with Jay Christopher. And he is known as the world's most dangerous one-man band, but also an amazing producer, and has helped her take her songs and sort of beef them up with a band behind him. And we're going to hear all about it. So here we go. Let's get to the interview with Jay Christopher and Samantha Grimes on Riverbend Talent.
Riverbend Talent on the Big Z. The Pigpen with you, brought to you by Halpin Music Company and by Mr. Matt Van Voorhis of Macias Insurance. And tonight, Pigpen, I'm excited to be talking to the world's most dangerous one-man band, Mr. Jay Christopher, and Samantha Grimes, who has just been on a tear with her new music that Jay Christopher has helped her produce. Thanks for coming on, guys.
It's our pleasure.
Yeah, thanks.
So let's get down to Mr. Jay Christopher. How did you come across the lovely Samantha Grimes? Where did you go to Wisconsin to find her yourself?
I've thought of it many times doing that. Actually, I saw her on a Facebook Live feed. She was sitting on her couch playing her guitar, doing original songs. And I'm always drawn to original songs, to original artists. And she just sat there and was just whipping right through them, played about 30 minutes of all original music, and just really, really good stuff.
So you originally contacted her, though, just to see if you could do one of her songs, right?
Well, one of the songs she did was called Wheaton County, and it's a rocker. A lot of her stuff is just, it's all complete by the time I get it musically. You know, the song ideas are all fashioned out. She puts the breaks in them. You hear them. You know what it's going to be when she's playing them. It's like, the band is implied. And she did this song called Wheaton County that really caught my ear. And I contacted her and I said, would it be all right if I covered the song? And she said, sure, have at it. And she sent me the lyrics. And later that afternoon, I was doing it.
That's pretty cool. Had you thought about at that point that maybe you would produce her at some point? Because that's what eventually happens, right?
Well, you know, she would sit in front of her couch playing her guitar, and she would do it night after night. I saw many of them. There was, you know, nights in these cold nights, I guess in Wisconsin, it's really cold, but she would play all these original tunes. And in between them, she would say things like, I can hear in my head what this would sound like with a full band. And I'm like, I hear it too. And that's the way that's the way it started. Eventually, she sent me an MP3 of her playing acoustic guitar and singing to a click, and they were on two tracks, and that was our first endeavor, was a song called Modern Severances.
So that Wheaton County song, Samantha, did you write that back when you were about 3 years old playing rubber bands on your dresser knob?
Pretty much.
Really? Is that song? You did that, though. For real. Yeah.
I did when I was a little girl. Between that and Kleenex box guitars, you know, that was the other thing you make when you're little. I knew I wanted strings of some sort, and that was the old school way of doing it.
Were you left-handed yet, or did that come later when you flipped the guitar upside down and played it like Jimi Hendrix did?
I was left-handed already, you know, and they tried to beat it out of you, but it stuck.
Yeah, so did you notice Jimi Hendrix after you started learning this way? I mean, you don't even reverse the strings, do you?
No, and honestly, when I started playing that way, I was 5, so I had no idea who Jimi Hendrix was.
Yeah.
I just knew that the guitar was too big, and I had it on my lap, like a slide guitar. And I guess I learned the blues that way, and then as I got a little older, it rose up, and around the age of 9, 10 is when somebody first said, hey, you're doing that wrong. And by then it was too late. It was already pretty ingrained.
Yeah, that's pretty cool, though. And, you know, you're not the first one to come along and flip it a different way or put it on your lap. But it definitely brings a uniqueness to you when people see it immediately. I'm sure they're thinking the same type of thing.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. And that's usually the first comment I get, especially, you know, come off stage. There's a handful of people that'll be like, you're playing it upside down. And they always say it like they're worried I don't know. And it's really funny to explain to them. And then they ask, you know, well, how do you read music and stuff? And I can't read music, but I can, if you're playing a guitar the normal, you know, right-handed way, I know where you are in it because I'm so used to seeing it that way. And I just flip it in my head.
Well, imagine you developed a pretty good ear because your father was a DJ, right? So you were always around music, right?
Yes. My dad was DJ Kegger Kim.
Nice.
Yes, he was a late night DJ playing all the new hits, which was Foreigner and Boston and Eagles. So yeah, that was
a radio guy then.
Yeah, he was a radio guy.
Now, did you get to stay up and listen to him?
No, he traded in his DJ turntables for the corporate life as I got older. So I still have 8-track recordings of him and some reel-to-reels of some of his old shows. So I can listen to that sometimes when I'm feeling nostalgic. But yeah, it's a trip.
Well, I would imagine when he was around the house and you were able to be with him, he was probably listening to music to prep for his show, though, right?
Oh, yeah. And he got all of the duplicates, the vinyls. They would send, you know, 2 copies and he would take the second copy home. So, you know, after he passed, that was my inheritance, was a record collection. So, yeah, we were always listening to everything.
I'm going to say that's not a bad inheritance to a guy who spends most of his money on music.
The work was done for me.
You saved me a bunch of trips to the store.
Exactly.
Well, that is seriously, that's a nice legacy to leave behind, a musical inheritance. So,
yeah,
I'm envious. And come on, Pigpen, you know, being in radio, it's like we inherit records from radio stations, right? You know, because there's extra copies laying around. So, you know,
wink, wink,
promotional copies.
Yep.
But it says on your website, 25 years you've been playing music. I don't know how long ago that was posted, but you don't seem like you're that old.
That's what I was about to say. Like, would you come out of the womb strumming a guitar? Come on.
I did. I felt very bad for my mother. There's a full dreadnought coming out of there. No, that's disgusting. Sorry. Actually, so I turned 35 this year.
Wow.
So, yeah, I did my first gig probably when I was around 10, 11. So, you know, that's fair to say that I've been performing at least that long. Right. But yeah, it's been a wild ride.
Yeah. And you put out quite a bit of stuff. You got a YouTube channel. But did you have the kind of success that you've had recently? Or is this kind of a new thing that's happening for you with all these plays and awards?
It's a whole different world. Yeah, it's completely different. I mean, my first real endeavor into performing and producing and getting music out there in the world was, gosh, I was 18, 19 years old. And, you know, we didn't have Spotify. We didn't have YouTube by any means. We had, you know, if you're lucky, you could get a song on MySpace that people would listen to. And even that was sketchy because people were on dial-up. So it was waiting 3 hours to hear your crappy song. So it's one of those things. I remember I went and cut an EP and released it in 2006, and you know, you have money and you get 1,000 copies and you sell them and you think you're a big shot. And then you find them at CD Baby or at the thrift store a year later and you're like, you know, it's not the same. And so I've kind of woven in and out of performing and writing and all that stuff. I mean, life just kind of goes. And it wasn't until about 2016 when I picked it back up. And I just kind of, I'd done a couple solo shows and stuff like that. And I thought, man, I miss writing new music. I miss performing with people and producing new music. And there's an entire way of getting that music out there into the universe that I never fully explored until then. So it was one of those things where while I, at the time, probably thought I was pretty cool doing the music industry the way I was, it completely pales in comparison to how things have been as of late. And with the success that I've had and that we've had in the couple of singles we've released, and just things have taken off. It's cool.
You had just mentioned some of your singles that you had put out, and I was asking Mr. J. Christopher, listened to the train wreck song the other day. One of the songs that you produced with her?
Yeah, it is. She was sitting on the couch playing a Facebook Live, and she goes, I like the way this sounds. And she plays the intro to train wreck. And then she plays train wreck. And it's not quite complete, but it's getting real close. And I thought the first time I heard it, I thought that's probably the best song that I'd heard that year. anywhere. That it, she's just a tremendous songwriter, and so.
And that song, that was a number one hit on 7522 radio. Is that correct?
Yeah. Yeah. In both rock and overall.
But you had another number one with them too, with Modern Severance, right?
Yeah. Yeah. That was a sleeper. So that went to number one.
Now, was that the same time you were nominated for the World Songwriters Award? Was it one of those songs?
Let's see here. So I was nominated for a couple last year, and Modern Severance would have been involved with that nomination. And this year it's all based on Trainwreck and Believe.
Nice. Yeah. And you're talking like hundreds of thousands of streams, right? With Trainwreck.
Yeah. Yeah.
Or yeah, both those songs.
So hundreds of thousands for both of those.
Wow.
Yeah. Them together were in the high hundreds of thousands, which makes me feel super cool, because up until then I think one of my songs had hit like the 110 mark, and I was thinking to myself, well, now I'm famous.
I've hit the triple digits here.
Yes, I'm triple digits, so there. So yeah, once those two singles, Trainwreck is really, that's the full steam ahead. But that is the one that really has garnered the most, just most plays, most attention. I mean, the not only the structure and the production of the song and everything that Jaded and like all of that went into the actual song itself, above and beyond that, the promotion that went into that song, I think was done really well. And I'm glad that kind of piggybacked off of that and emulated it with Believe. And then, you know, every subsequent song that's come or that will be coming is going to be on the same structure. So I think we stumbled onto, how do the young kids say it? Some sort of algorithm that seems to be paying off.
Nice.
Well, it's cool that you mentioned young kids, because that's something we do with our show is, you know, we got a lot of musicians that listen to this show, and they're all sitting around right now wondering, how can I get my song to have 100,000 streams, you know? And
start,
you know,
with a good song,
right,
kids.
Start with a good song.
Yeah.
But is there, you know, we've heard a few things along the way. Is there anything that you've done to generate some attention towards yourself to get these plays, or has it been all just here it is and there it goes?
You know, I think there's always a component. Wow. It's been a long day. There's always a component of things being organic. So, you know, just general people stumbling across your music, it being put on playlists on Spotify, or someone shares your video on YouTube. That's all one thing. But there's a whole other part that comes into it. And that's just you trying to stay relevant. It sounds stupid, and maybe it sounds attention grabbing or whatnot, but I make it a point to be on social media and updating my site and doing all those kind of things almost every day, so that you're always in the forefront of somebody's mind when it comes to original music, regardless of what genre you are. I mean, there are people that love every type of music. So if you appeal to them and reach them where they're comfortable, they have that much more of a reason to actually listen. And to, you know, followers is such a cliche term, but to really sink in and be a part of your journey. And that's where I think you've got to put the most effort into, is just being present. Cause you can't, it doesn't matter how great the song is. If you're like, okay, I'm done, and you put it on the shelf and you don't do anything with it, nobody's going to hear it. So you definitely have to believe in yourself first and foremost and get it out there.
It's those algorithms you were talking about. If you make a post and you don't post again for 6 months, nobody sees that post except whoever saw it the day you posted it.
But yeah, exactly.
Posting and keep relevant, it keeps popping up more and more. So algorithms.
That's right, my friend. You are correct.
Algorithms is also a great name for a backup band. You know, like
the algorithms. Yeah.
How about the 53s? Would that be a good name for a backup band?
It's not as magic as the 33s. No, that 53s is a great name.
Yeah, if you had John Larson on bass and Nick Englehart playing drums, does that sound familiar, Samantha?
That does. You know, those names ring a bell. you know, it came to be the B-52s were busy, so we had to go with something close. I don't know, 53-foot radius is how far one of their ankle monitors is allowed. So it's just, We have a whole slew of funny things we say on stage to explain that, but in all honesty, they're phenomenal musicians. I'm very fortunate that, you know, I, because being somebody who did solo for many years, there's an element to that that's intimate and beautiful and has its place. But gosh, when you can hear, even as simple as a three piece, when you can hear the bass, the drums, and whatever main instrument, that just ties it together in my head enough where it's like, yeah, I want to keep doing this. I want to present it at least in this function, in this way. So I love those guys. They've
The 53s.
All right.
The
53s. Lots of reasons why they're called the 53s. I'm going to guess it's the combined age of all three of them. I don't know.
They're going to love you for saying that. I'm the baby compared to them. So
now I want to bring up another song that I listened to called Damage. Is this one of the singles that you put out? Because this is another great song.
Damage isn't out yet. Although it is one of my favorite songs to play live. I saw a video of this song.
So it's not out. It's not out as a studio recording. It's just out as the you sitting on your couch playing it.
Yeah. Well, so I've got me on the couch playing it. I got me in my basement playing it. I've got a couple of live versions of playing it on stage. Jay and I were just talking that we just got a master back of the studio version that we're listening to. So I'm getting jazzed. So it will be out. It's just not out yet.
Good choice. That is another, that's a good, I listened to several of them and the Train Wreck and Damage kind of jumped out at me. There's another, I think Old Fashioned or something like that. It was called, it was a good,
I never play that one.
Good, very good song. So let's talk just for a minute about the process, because Jay is here in our area and you're way up north. Oh, in all Wisconsin. Yeah. And
I'm sure you betcha.
What was that?
Sure, you betcha. Do you want a Coke?
Oh, yeah. You betcha. Yeah,
we'll get you one.
AAA? Oh, no.
Yeah. Jay will tell you about the song, and then I'll go get you a hot dish.
I'd like to know a little bit about the recording process, because, she's way up there. She's sending you these songs, and then you're basically putting the band behind it and filling it in. What is the process in there, doing that digitally?
Usually the way it works is she will send me a copy of her singing on one track and playing acoustic on one track to a click. And then I will bring that together. And like Damage is a good example. Damage, I knew it was going to be a rocker, so I put it all together, got it framed up, and then I sent it to a guy named Rob Lee, who plays drums on Trainwreck, and he plays drums on Damage, and he really knocks the bottom out of it. It's he's something else. And then after that, it comes back to me. I'll send it back up to Sam. She'll listen to it, make any critiques, and then it comes back to me, and I'll add, I usually add the bass at that point, and then we send it back and forth until we just get it worked out till it becomes a song.
So she sends you these raw songs, but then once you put them to a click track, there's your skeleton or whatever to keep everything on track.
Right.
Yes. And then you just build it one piece at a time going. You don't put the whole song together, send it to him, and go, what do you think? You kind of build it one piece at a time back and forth.
Well, I have to go ahead.
I was gonna say he loves to give you the pie that he just baked and say, here, you like it? And every pie I've had has been completely done. I don't know if it's a kismet thing or if we're just on the same wavelength, but I'll send him the raw stuff and I'll say, I hear this. And then boom, all of a sudden, like 2 weeks later, it's got bass, it's got drums that he sent to Rob. It's got, B3 organ, or it has, what was that? What did we add to Damage that I loved? And all I said to him was, I hear womp, 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 womp.
Neutron bass.
Yes.
the music.
I'm like, I remember it from the 90s. I remember all these songs. Bah, 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 bah. And he's like, what the heck are you talking about? And then he got it and he sent it to me. I'm like, yes, that's what I hear in my head. And so pretty much anything that we've worked on, you know, to fruition like that, I call him Keebs. He cooks up and he sends it on over, and it always is fantastic.
Well, that, you know, what a great world it is where you can do this. Mm-hmm. You know, 15 years ago, 20 years ago, you would have had to go to Wisconsin, or Samantha would have had to come down here to make this all possible. Before we move on to any more questions, though, I do want to comment on this Rob Lee that you're bringing in for the drums.
Yeah.
Man, great drummer. Great drummer.
Why do you hear Damage? Damage is unbelievable. Rob is from New Orleans. He moved up to this area, St. Louis area, with his girlfriend. Rob was in the Mondin band with me. Rob also plays with the Soulard Blues Band. And he teaches, I believe, at SWCC, maybe. So he's, and the cool thing about Rob is that he's got a definite sound about him. He comes right off the vinyl. I mean, he'll pull you right in and grab you. Doesn't sound like any other drummer in St. Louis. And my favorite part about Rob is that he frames everything. Here's a verse framed. Here's a chorus coming in. You know it's coming in. Here's the ending. He sets it up. He just sets everything up. He does it all on computer. So he's very computer savvy. He's just a treat to work with.
Yeah. Well, excellent drummer. I don't know how he is to work with, but he's great to listen to.
Excellent drummer. A wonderful guy. I'll send you a copy of Damage so you can hear that.
I'm excited to hear it.
His drums on Damage is, well, in fact, I stuck it out front. It's so far up in the mix. You know, I can tell Rob stuff like this. Think Stuart Copeland. And that's what he gives me.
Yeah.
I can say, I did a song with him called Nectarine. I said, think of Marvin Gaye about Doggone period. Not the brother period. Yeah. And he knocks, great shuffle drummer, unbelievable drummer.
Now that song was done with Matt, right? Matt Mahoney?
Yeah, we did Nectarine with Matt Mahoney. He came back from California after the COVID thing. He had spent it out there, and he came back to the house. Me and him have been writing together. He says to me, I want to write a song about nectarines. And I says, well, okay, but, you know, we got to do something with it. And so we listened to it. You know, he had some stuff worked out, and we sat at my kitchen table and chopped through the lyrics. And when it was finally done, it was heavily, there was a lot of sexual innuendo added. I've tried to stop adding sexual innuendo songs, but it's hard.
Nectarines are sexy.
It's really hard, I'm telling you.
It's hard to think about a nectarine and not think about sex. I don't know.
I don't know. Plus,
it's nectarine hard.
Rhymes with cuisine.
Nectarine and gasoline? I don't know.
It sounds like most of the songs you guys do, Samantha, that you kind of get them down with the guitar and just you first and play them several times before you start building with Jay. Is that how it kind of goes?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. I get some, I let them marinate a little.
Yeah.
Get some flavor.
But, yeah, I mean, I would say 60% of my set, or I should say my catalog, that sounds a little bit more realistic, has been stuff that, you know, 15 years old, and it's just old stuff. So that's been in stone. And I always, and Jay's extremely respectful of it, but I always tell him, like, I'm married to this song. Like, I've been playing it this way for so long. You try to change it, I will have some sort of combustion inside my brain. So those ones are all old, but like the new ones that I've written, like Damage is a new one. And Black Eyeliner and like a couple of these other ones, they are all ones that I wrote, had lyrics down, had the strum pretty much down, and then I would send it to him and be like, hey, what do you think?
Yeah.
But most of the songs are completely done when she sends them to me. The whole form of it, there's no, you know, there's no questioning it. You know what it's going to be. She doesn't leave, like, this will be a solo section or something like that. That never happens. In fact, I don't think there is any solo sections.
So she's got the arrangement complete. She's got the lyrics complete, the arrangement complete. You just dress everything around what she's done.
Pretty much. And I try and keep, whenever she sends me a part, that part goes on the record. I don't overplay her parts. That's her guitar playing is always excellent. Her piano playing is always excellent. And she's got this freight train rhythm style that you just, it's all very integral to the whole pie. You got to have
my left hand.
That bloody left hand.
My bloody left hand.
Yeah.
Stupid shout, Porsche.
Yep.
She plays rhythm like Richie Havens.
Nice.
I was going to say, I think I read something about you build off of riffs, right? And then lyrics come after that, right?
Yep. Yeah, that's pretty accurate.
That's the Van Halen method, right? Yeah. Lots of guitar.
Just watched a documentary on Van Halen. I think yes, I completely resonate. Yeah.
Yeah.
Only Eddie was doing it with his right hand. Anybody could do that.
That's true. Yeah. Well, he had both hands.
Yeah.
And you gotta add too about Sam's lyrics. They're highly intelligent. They're really good stuff. I mean, it's I like the way she says everybody's getting by with Riesling and laughter.
Riesling, the wine. We're all getting by with the wine.
Yes. I would have said wine and they're drunk. <You know? laughs>
Syllables. I was told by somebody that said I was way too wordy. He's like, I can't do anything with this. It's just too many words. You got to dumb it down. I'm like, but I can't.
Don't do it.
So you're signed to Return Records, which The Orchard is a distribution from Sony, right?
Yep. And actually, that is kind of coming to the end of its terms. So I am just kind of looking for what the opportunities are going to be after this. And not that haven't been phenomenal to work with and everything, but it's taught me a lot kind of as things have transpired of where to protect yourself and where to really go more gung-ho and be more at the reins of what's going on. So I'm looking forward to this next year, I think, between I've got the distribution side and now it'll be a lot more promotion on my, so I'm excited.
That's what I was kind of curious about is how much they helped you with promotion, because I noticed you get tons of radio play and we've all tried to do that with our bands. It's a lot of time invested in contacting a radio station over and over and over sometimes, and I was wondering, did they help you with that or was that you doing that on your own?
Technically, it was me on my own, but I did partner with an agency, actually. So long story short, when baby Sam was coming into the world, I started my career out in accounting and I worked for a CPA. And this CPA did the accounting for this guy who had this music promotion company in Minneapolis. And I remember being like, hey, sir, I play the music. Do you want to meet me? And of course, he's like, no, thank you, dumb little kid. I'm not going to do anything with this. Fast forward 20 years later, whatever, 15 years later. And I wrote him out of the blue and I said, I don't know if you remember me, but I'm doing this. And Tinderbox has worked with Semisonic and a ton of huge names. And I said, I need help. And they do radio promotion, specifically kind of geared towards college radio and independent stations. And that's where we ended up going out on like 35 markets and hundreds of radio stations. And a lot of them we charted on, which was just, I don't know, it was something I hadn't even registered in my brain as a goal. So to be able to go in and see that on the charts and well-placed on the charts, it wasn't even like, wow, she's way down there in the 900s. It was really cool to see how well it performed, and ran that promotion for a good 10 weeks. And then thanks to that success, then from that, we've got sync licenses and stuff like that all come into the mix. So it's just snowballing.
I seen a note somewhere it was 8,800 radio stations.
Yep. Yeah. That's when you tally them all up in the continental United States and Alaska and Hawaii, that is how many it came up to.
That is busy.
Yeah.
It is busy. Now, I thought I heard some sort of rumor about one of the songs, maybe Trainwreck. NASCAR showing some interest in it?
No, not out of line at all. So I've got, there were three songs out of my kind of recent releases. And one of them is Black Eyeliner that comes out May 31st. But these three songs, Trainwreck, Kingmaker, which is another one that was released, and then Black Eyeliner, those three were part of the sync license pitch that went out to all these different places. And NASCAR Channel is one that picked it up, and Discovery Channel, PBS. There's just like a whole bunch that are showing this interest. Now, granted, it's one of those where you might not see the fruits of your labor until a little later, but just knowing that there's an agreement there and they have me ready to use, it's just... It's the first time you'll hear a woman that's like, yes, use me. I'm so excited. So it's going to be awesome.
Yeah. Even if the fruits of the labor aren't immediate, just to know that the Learning Channel is interested in your song.
Mm-hmm.
That would be enough to go, you actually listened to it? I figured you would have thrown it away.
Exactly. When you see the logo on those, Jay will tell you, you see it on those documents and you're like, I know them. They're on my cable. It's just really cool.
Yeah, that is neat.
So, I see that you're up for the 8th Annual Josie Music Award, right?
I am. That's nominated. Super exciting that the GMA is.
Rising Star, is that the category? And
that is.
Do you get to play in the Grand Ole Opry, or do you have to win?
Well, I think you have to win.
Oh, you do?
But I get to go to the Grand Ole Opry.
Okay.
I secretly think I should just run and start screaming on stage, and that will count as singing at the Grand Ole Opry.
I'm cool with that.
I'll count it.
I think they'll say that will go viral, and then people will be like, see that girl on TikTok that had some sort of episode? And then they'll be like, come play for real. I've got it all worked out in my head.
I see there was a concert like October 23rd at the Grand Ole Opry House in Nashville for... I guess the nominated, or I don't understand exactly who gets to play that. That's what I'm trying to figure out.
Yeah. So they asked a couple nominees. I think some of the more prevalent ones were like, there's vocal duo of the year and those kind of, I think they're having those people perform. And then they're having a couple past winners perform as well. So yeah, they're doing their JMA Fest concert, which is sounds like a heck of a party. But I will not be playing. Oh.
How about the night before?
I'm going to try to hit up someplace in Nashville and play the night before.
I was going to say, I seen where there were like four stages or six stages and four venues, something like that, the night before that.
I'm just going to show up on the strip and start crying with my guitar until somebody says, come in here and do that inside.
What about the ISSA one? That's in August, right?
Atlanta? Yeah, those are in August in Atlanta. And yeah, I'm up for 5 awards for that. So two that are really exciting. Trainwreck is up for Single of the Year, which is really cool. And I'm also up for Songwriter of the Year, which I'm really excited about. That's a huge honor, even to be a first for it. Because, I mean, you had rounds and rounds of voting nationwide. First you have to be nominated, then voting. And then you make it to the finals, and then it's up to the judges. But just to make it this far is really cool. It's an honor.
Yeah. So how much of that time on social media leading up to this point, engaging fans, helped out when you started needing votes, huh?
Oh, huge. Huge.
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah.
And I don't know, maybe for those that are listening that are looking for ways to simplify their reach, I use a company called Hootsuite that does my Twitter, my Instagram, my Facebook, ties it all into one. And then it can kind of shake up what times each one goes on each social media channel. So it's not like you're all on the same one at the same time. And that was instrumental in getting the reach, but not being abrasive or obnoxious and repetitive. And I think that was huge. And what was really cool was it timed out perfectly with the radio promotion stuff that was going on. So while I was hitting everyone hard on social, it was also on the airwaves, which I think really helped.
Me and Pigpen basically started this show for that reason, that it was always hard for us to like push ourselves, you know, our bands on other people, but it's easy for us to talk about your bands, right? So we had the opportunity to do that, and we know how much it matters to those bands. It's tough, but you know, we hear it from the successful people that, you know, you got to be persistent, you got to be that way, and you know, get over it, because that's your only hope.
I think it's kind of what you said, though, how you had the company that mixed and mingled it and put it at different times, because there's this fine line you're trying to ride of being relevant without being annoying. And, you know, if you can find that golden spot to ride between those two places, you got it.
That's what she said. Sorry, I couldn't help it. You put it right there.
I threw you the softball. All you had to do was
thank you. But you are entirely accurate. You have to kind of walk that fine line and make sure that people aren't like, oh my gosh, again, here she is. And then just making sure that what you're doing matters. I mean, I wouldn't put out on social media or anything and say like, ooh, I just took a shower. You know, that's the wrong kind of attention that I want. But to share like, hey, I just came up with this really cool little riff that I'm going to try to write to. People really respond to that. And then you watch your views go into the thousands for just a 15-second clip. That's pretty cool.
Man, so I shouldn't have just taken a picture of my muffin and said, this just happened on Facebook.
Correct. Yes, that is Facebook from 2007. So
this is where I'm messing up.
Yeah. So you're still on the, like, remember when it was so-and-so is doing this. That's old school. Samantha Grimes is playing music. Now you get to be all vague and cool and be like, celery, food for thought, winky face. No one gets it, but they're excited.
I forgot to mention Pigpen, when she was nominated for that Josie Music Award, there's like 52,000 people or more that submitted stuff. So to get nominated, you're in like the 2% category. Who gets nominated.
1.8%. Yes, you are correct.
I got it down to the 0.8.
I read that too and I was like, no way.
Yeah, that's pretty exciting.
Yeah, to have that much to sift through and find yourself that a needle in the haystack, that's good. That just shows you're doing at least one thing right, if not more. I think one of the greatest things you probably did was hook up with Jay Christopher.
Yeah,
because that way we got to
clearly. Yes, 100%. That is honestly the only reason I'm here.
So, are we going to get to see you in town, or did we miss you coming in town? Is there ever going to be a Samantha Grimes show around here?
There should be. Wouldn't that be fun, Jay? We should do that. Something tells me you'd be able, as a one-man band, to perhaps set up the back line.
You give me the day, and I'll get us booked.
Question, will you pay for the gas?
$4 a gallon?
Don't you have an electric
car? If you're lucky. Oh, no. They don't work up here in the north.
we'll put her on a Greyhound. How's that?
Yeah, come on. There we go. Girl, oh, gosh, that'd make a song. Greyhound.
Rode in on a Greyhound. It's the first line out of a CCR song. What is
I'm
it?
Telling you.
Yes.
Lodi.
Stuck in Lodi there again. There you go, baby.
And
you know, when you're referencing Creedence, it's good.
You'll be right there with all the blues legends in history that took the bus from Chicago to St. Louis because they knew they were going to get paid when they got to St. Louis and get a meal.
Yeah,
there we go.
We've heard that from blues guys going both ways, whether they were coming from New Orleans and Memphis up to Chicago or coming from Chicago down. They loved to stop in St. Louis because they knew they were going to get a little bit of money and a meal, where most places you just paid and were told to get the heck out. You know, so we will make sure you get a meal at least when you come to town.
Well, you guys may not know this about him, but he is a fantastic half pictures of the food that he makes, mainly because I make toast and perhaps cereal, but he makes these fine cuisines. And I'm always just sitting there like, why are you showing me this? I'm not there. I don't get to eat that. This is cruel.
Trying to entice you.
They're like, here's some, God, what did you make? Some kind of stew or something that you were cooking that one time. And like, come on down.
Trying to entice her. I get it.
Yeah. Or he'll be like, ride the motorcycle. The wind feels good. And I'll be like, I can't.
Well, we're going to entice you to come down here. We're going to get you down here because we got to play. We got to see the whole show, not just the videos.
So. Fair enough. Can I come and do it right in that nice little studio you got right there?
Oh, we got better venues than this.
We
do.
We'll figure out a great place.
I'll hold you to that.
Be fun. Yeah.
So
we got lots of them to choose from.
Well, is there anything? I'm sorry, what's that, Jay?
We got lots of places for her to play down here.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. So I know you're working on Damage right now, trying to finish up the tracks for Damage. Anything else? Any other big ones on the way we can expect?
Well, she's got a release Tuesday,
May 31st. yeah, that one's called Black Eyeliner. And that was it's kind of a funny story. I had time at the Institute of Production and Recording up in Minneapolis, and I got to go and record this track, and then got it mixed and all that jazz, and now it's ready to be released. And I don't know, it's really cool. It's a song I do in drop D, which is my only one that I perform in drop D, so it's kind of my little drop D baby. I really like it.
You're getting a little heavy there with some drop D, getting a little
especially when it's all the way on the bottom of the guitar strings, man.
Yeah, she does stuff we don't even comprehend, I'm sure.
I don't even comprehend where I am right now.
You know, speaking of that, whenever she sends me her guitar parts, there's no way I can copy them because there's a certain sonority of her playing upside down.
Yeah.
So if I add stuff, I'm playing in the other direction, which makes it a huge sounding guitar sound. And that's the way we develop these guitar sounds.
Wow.
Yeah.
So I'm playing up one direction and me playing in the other direction.
Yeah. It's like when a shoe box and the shoes have to match into the box.
Kind of.
I could see that with a guitar upside down like that. Everything she does feels like an upstroke at some level.
That's what I'm thinking. Yeah.
Absolutely.
You could do some great reggae.
I have been told that, and every once in a while I reggae it up. So yeah, that definitely translates well to my guitar style.
Oh, I bet it does. Well, that's awesome. You got anything else, or can we just invite him down here now? You guys just come on down.
We got a party started. Let's go for it. You know,
D town, drop D town.
So I know
on some stew.
I did notice on the website that alternative pop rock was kind of your genre, but kind of all over the place, right?
Everywhere. I save for screamy metal rap, I kind of dabble in all. I'm an opportunist. Whatever the song calls for. Lately I just was made a part of the Midwest Country Music Association, which is kind of funny because I never considered any of my music country, probably not until Jay played Wheaton County, and I was like, wow, that sounds very ish. So I think we're kind of going towards like country alternative rock, maybe, is where the best blend of that is. I don't know what I am. I'm still growing.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's you're a musician.
We're going to put Damage dead serious rock. It's rock. That's all.
Yeah. Absolutely. I can see that. I can see that being a rocking out song, man.
It's a rock tune. I'm going to send you the new remaster. You're going to love it.
I'm going to. I already know it. I liked it when she was just sitting on her couch playing it. So.
That's right.
She's got some other ones that I really want to work on, like Make Up My Mind for Me. That's a real rocker. It's the down the like Jet or AC/DC type sound. It's good stuff.
And then your website is at SamanthaGrimes.com.
SamanthaGrimesMusic.com because SamanthaGrimes.com, I believe, is a realtor. We're not the same. I know. She took my domain name, which is just harsh. So, yes,
we're going to have to Scooby-Doo her. We're going to have to Scooby-Doo her.
Yes.
You know what I mean?
Yes.
And we'll get away with it if it isn't for those Menling kids.
That's right.
But
if you Google Samantha Grimes, it all just comes up. The website, the book face, the Instagram, all that jazz, along with YouTube, Spotify, iHeart, everywhere that it is, you will find me.
Yeah, that's the main thing, is I'm trying to get folks to find you because you're not here, but we're trying to get you here.
We're good.
Yes.
All right.
Here's what we're going to do. We're going to crowdsource the Greyhound. Hey. Everybody, I just need the ticket. Now I'm Coleman.
All right.
Well, we need $25 a piece. We can get her here.
I think a Greyhound ticket's $12.50. No, I don't know.
As long as Jay's going to feed her, we're okay.
No. Well, hey, thanks so much for taking your evening, part of your evening to hang out with us here over the old internet and tell us a little bit more about Samantha Grimes. Look forward to trying to get you to town so we can tell everyone in this city about you and let them all find out about you.
It's been my pleasure. Thank you so much.
And I know Jay's doing a good job of promoting you because the folks around town that know Jay have definitely heard of Samantha Grimes as well. So nice job, Jay, and also helping out with Matt as well. So that's pretty cool.
Always looking for new talent.
Yeah, we're going to have you back on. We're out of time now, but we appreciate both you guys coming on with us tonight.
Well, thanks for having us.
Thank you so much.
All right. Thanks so much to our guests, Jay Christopher and Samantha Grimes, our sponsors, Halpin Music Company, Matt Van Voorhis of Macias Insurance. Everybody get a chance to check out the Samantha Grimes videos, and everybody this week get out and check out some local music and art.